thanks for tuning in. So today's a bit of a departure from my usual eating whispering videos. I'm going to be talking about some of my vinyl records. Now, I've selected 20 vinyl records that mean something to me, maybe not to everybody, but they're kind of like a chunk of my life. I'm not saying these are the 20 best records of mine or my favorite, or they're, 20 of the best records that ever was recorded, not like that at all. I've selected these records because when I listen to them, or when I actually see the record, it takes me back to a place in my life, where I was then emotionally, physically, spiritually, if I was in a relationship and where I was working at that time. So anyways, and I think we're all like that. We all have certain music selections that take us back. So anyways, first up is Tom Petty and the Heartbreakers, Damn the Torpedoes. When I first heard this record, it floored me. I think I heard this back in 79, thereabouts. I remember I was working for a budget rented truck, driving trucks all over, I was in a relationship with a girl named Cindy, and, I think we were probably living together that time, and I remember it was cold out, and that sort of thing. But, it was, it actually, now that I mention it, I think my relationship with Cindy was just ending, But anyways, it really takes me back, Great record, I loved it. I love the production, the music. Tom Petty's voice kind of sounded like some early Dylan. Anyways, I really like that record. It was really good production. I saw Tom Petty a couple of times. The first time was in 1982. The Fabulous Thunderbirds were the opening act. They had to pull out because one of their band members was ill. So it was the whole entire concert was Tom Petty and the Heartbreakers, and they sounded fabulous. I saw them again in 86 with Bob Dylan. They shared a stage, and that was really good too. So Steely Dan, Asia. This takes me back right away back to the 70s. I was sharing a house with three other guys, and we all drove pickup trucks. We all had cameras and took pictures, and we all had the same address, and we listened to a lot of Steely Dan back then. So and I've got a lot of Steely Dan in my collection, so whenever I drink Kahlua or listen to Steely Dan, it takes me back to those days. So a lot of fond memories. Ozark Mountain Daredevils, kind of a rock, southern rock genre, country rock, southern rock. I got into these guys in the 70s when I was working in a logging camp. Can't remember who turned me on to them or how I heard about them, but I ended up buying a lot of their records too. Just like Steely Dan, I've got probably, 7 or 8 of their albums. I want to say one thing about Ozark Mountain Daredevils. Their vocals and harmonies are excellent. They're absolutely superb, and recordings are always really good. If you hear a song called Leatherwood from the, I believe it's this one, the Carl of the Lake album. Leatherwood. Beautiful song. Just beautiful. Check out that song, Leatherwood. Unbelievable. Anyways, David Lindley, El Rayo X. Back in the early 80s, I was playing in a reggae band. Somebody said, Springsteen, Greetings from Asbury Park. This record was, I was turned on to this by a buddy of mine. And, of course, I had to buy a few Springsteen records like everybody else did. I saw Bruce Springsteen in June of 1978. And I've never seen a performer with so much energy and stage presence. For his age, I think he was barely 30. He had so much energy and professionalism. I guess most people in the 30 have a lot of energy, but the E Street Band sounded fabulous. You know, Little Steven, Clarence Clemens, Max Weinberg on the drums. I saw them in a theater where you'd see an opera. There's about 2,000 seats. You know, we were like on the floor with the 14th row back. Just beautiful. The sound was amazing. They were so good, and they were the only act. You know, they're just fabulous. Once again, when I see that album, I think of Springsteen. I think of all that energy. Just amazing. So, Meatloaf, Bat Out of Hell. I still remember where I was. I was just starting to date my girlfriend Cindy back in 79, there about 78, 79, when this record came out. And I was sharing an apartment with my buddy Barry. And we were sharing an apartment, and I had a delivery moving business. I had my own truck, a great big truck. And it was a 5-ton, and I was, that's how I made my living back then. I gave it up because it was just too much hard work, even for a young guy. I thought this could be an easier way to make a living. But anyways, this record blew me away. I wouldn't say it's overproduced, but it was probably more, it was a lot better produced than most records I was listening to at that time. Very good. I mean, Meatloaf's voice is astounding. That there's very few people in the business that sing as good as Meatloaf. I mean, just so good. Yeah, look at this one. Pink Floyd, Dark Side of the Moon. I had heard of Pink Floyd for years before I actually started listening to them. I always thought their music was really different, and of course when Dark Side of the Moon came out, it became a commercial success. And I listened to this record over and over. I guess I was about 15 when I bought this. And we were all into that, all my buddies and I. It was, you know, Pink Floyd, that sort of thing. And I saw Pink Floyd a couple times. The first time was on my 18th birthday, April the 8th, 1975. They were at the in Vancouver at the Pacific Coliseum. And, you know, when you hear a band on stage, a lot of times you notice it doesn't sound like the record. And there's a lot of reasons that bands don't play like the record. It could be a lot of personal reasons, but sometimes it's technical reasons. And then the biggest technical reason is it's hard to reproduce on stage what you do in the studio. Pink Floyd absolutely blew me away because they performed the whole Dark Side of the Moon record flawlessly live on stage with all the effects, you know, the laughing, the running, you know, the saxophone, which was live, the female vocals were all live. They had everybody they needed. They had all the effects they needed. It was all put together, not like nowadays where everything's all sampled. They had to, you know, sync all this up, and it was just absolutely perfect. I could honestly say that concert could rival anything today for lights and sound. Unbelievable. You know, not easy to reproduce that album live on stage. I saw them again in 1994. Not quite as impressed. I think they were just kind of jumping through the hoops. That's the impression I got. But nonetheless, they were very good. And they were also playing in a bigger stadium, which is built for, you know, football games and tractor pulls. So the sound wasn't as good. A lot of reverberation and that sort of thing. So, oh, now, look at this one. I got this for Christmas. I was probably about 7 or 8 years old. About 7, I think. And the Beatles, Something New. And I still remember that picture from the Ed Sullivan Show, you know. And I remember when I unwrapped it, I just lost it. I was a Beatle fanatic from the first time I saw him on Ed Sullivan, February the 9th, 1964. And I loved the Beatles, you know. And So this takes me back to that same Christmas. I still remember opening it up. I remember phoning my neighbor next door and telling him that I got the Beatles something new. And there's a German version of I Want to Hold Your Hand. The exact same music track, but they're just singing it in German. It's very good. You know, I don't like that phrase, all killer, no filler, but I'm going to use it here anyways because I never heard a Beatle record that didn't have, you know, every song was good. You know, every song you listen to on a Beatle record is good. You know, so all killer, no filler. Okay, now, the very first Dylan record I ever bought, Blood on the Tracks, I bought that in 1975. I believe it was released in January 75, and I bought it shortly after. You can see how it's worn. So I went and bought a second copy. The artwork is slightly different on the back. You can see that the artwork is the newer one, this one here. They changed the artwork on the back a little bit. Same record though. But I was blown away. You know, I became a Bob Dylan fan. I was well aware of Dylan for years, like I mentioned before in one of my other videos. But when I heard Lily Was Mary and the Jack Hearts, I had to buy this record. I bought this record and I played it and played it and played it. And I was going to high school at the time, still living home with mom and dad and my little sister, my older sister. And you know, it still takes me back. You know, I listen to those songs in the car, you know. Like I said, I get, you know, music off Spotify, or, you know, I got a lot of DVDs and that sort of thing. And I still listen to it, you know, and I love it. It's just, it's fabulous. So, Electric Light Orchestra, El Dorado. I saw these guys, I'd heard of them, but I went and saw Deep Purple played November 17th, 1974. I still remember that because I was so excited. And the tickets were $6. And there was three bands. The first band was Elf. The second band was Electric Light Orchestra. And then, of course, Deep Purple were the headliners. Electric Light Orchestra came out and absolutely stole the show. They were fabulous, absolutely fabulous. They played a lot off this record, plus Rollover Beethoven, that sort of thing. But these guys with cellos and violins just running around the stage, and just, they sounded so good and so professional. I mean, they were just amazing, and they should have been the headliners. I mean, I was a Deep Purple fanatic at that time, and I was a little bit disappointed in their concert because their records are always so polished and so tight, and their concerts were, you know, kind of a little bit less than that. So, anyways, so The Doors. I was in high school when I first heard this record. Some friends turned me on to it. We'd skip class, go back to you know, my friend's house, and we'd listen to this among other records, and it just takes me back. The minute I hear this, I'm right back to 19, you know, 74, 75, you know. It was recorded, I think, in the late 60s, early 70s, I'm not quite sure, but, you know, Love Her Madly. I mean, the drums sound so good in this record. This record is, for its time, the sound is amazing, you know. Probably recorded on very few tracks. They probably only recorded, I'm guessing, on maybe 8 or 10 tracks. Not a lot of overproduction, you know. But just beautifully done. Very good. Now, another record from my high school. I bought this once again in 75. I remember it was wintertime. It was all slushy and cold and snow and slush. And I bought this because I saw these guys on TV. There used to be a show called Don Kirshner's Rock Concert and Midnight Special and In Concert. And I used to stay up late and watch all those shows on the weekends. And these guys were on there quite a bit. They kind of reminded me, Paul Rodgers was the front man for this band. They kind of reminded me of an English Creedence Clearwater or something. I'm not quite sure, but they were a little bit different, you know. Very, not an overproduced band, very basic, but very, very tight and very good. us on Spotify. Fabulous record. Well, for three guys, and if you see their concerts, you know, on YouTube or wherever, they're mind-blowing. You know, what they do on stage, you know, speaking of reproducing records, I mean, they sound as good live as they do on stage, I mean, as they do in the studio. Years ago, back in the 70s, they played in the town I live in, which is not a big town. It's only 100,000 people, but it was even smaller then. And I'd heard of Rush, but I didn't, I wasn't interested. They played, and some friends of mine saw them, said they were just fabulous. I thought, oh, that's nice, good for you. Well, the next year they played, and I was thinking of going to see them. And as it turned out, they had to cancel because their stage configuration would not fit into the arena. So they had to cancel at the last minute. So they had actually they were starting to really expand everything about them. They were just getting bigger, you know, musically, and their stage act was just getting bigger. And needless to say, they became one of the biggest bands in the world. Just fabulous. Okay. Speaking of Deep Purple, I bought this when I was about 15. When I heard Smoke on the Water, I was blown away. I mean, it's probably the most famous riff in the world, you know, a guitar riff. Ian Paice's drumming, slick and tight, never repeats himself, never uses the same roll twice, you know. Very good. Vocals were superb. Everything about this band was superb, you know. I loved Ian Gillan's vocals, you know. Just great, you know, really good record. A real history to it, the way it was recorded, you know, in a hotel room and all that. I think most people know the story, but anyways, check it out. If you're not a Deep Purple fan, I get it, but if you were going to buy a record, I would suggest you buy this one. Yeah, that one takes me back, that's for sure. Okay, Itty Gritty Dirt Band, Uncle Charlie. I used to have a reel-to-reel tape recorder, which I mentioned in some of my videos, and that was my source of music. That was my Spotify, you know. I'd record music off the radio, whatever. And I eventually sold it, and I can't remember how much I got for it, but I got enough money to buy a lot of records, and this was one of them. Records back then were about $5, you know, or $3.99 if you got them on sale. This has Mr. Bojangles on it. It has a great intro, you know. Very good bluegrass music, if that's what you're into, and that's what I was in. Back then in high school, I was very open-minded. I was listening to a lot of different music. I was getting turned on to a lot of things, so I really enjoyed that record. And I still just, I saw an Eddie Gritty Dirt Band in 2014. They came to town, and they were so good. And very, very funny, very entertainment, very entertaining. Okay. Uriah Heep, Demons and Wizards. I bought this when I was in high school. I think I bought this around 72 as well, with my hard-earned money. It's the sound of this record. There's a lot of acoustic guitar on it. It's recorded just fabulous. I mean, the acoustic guitar sounds like it was recorded yesterday. I mean, the quality is that good, very good. There's a blend of some harder rock, like Easy Living is a kind of hard rock tune, but the song The Wizard is just fabulous to listen to, and I love it. I just played this to death. It takes me back to the days of, recreational use, that sort of thing, as a teenager, and sitting in my parents' basement, smoking cigarettes, and I would listen to that on their big stereo console, you know. Okay, Kansas. Yeah, I was working in a logging camp when I bought this. Can't remember where I first heard Carry On Wayward Son, but I was absolutely blown away. I love, everything about this record. You know, it was so good, so tight, so polished. When you listen to it now, it's like there's a little too much compression on it. And the style back then to record was, a lot of the sound was kind of like a dead sound. There was not a lot of reverberation. You know, the drums all kind of dead, you know, that sort of thing, which is unfortunate, but it's still an excellent record. Very good. And like I said, I never get tired of listening to Carry On Wayward Son. It's just, the whole record is almost operatic. for his Lynyrd Skynyrd. You know, kind of back to my southern rock genre. Once again, same era as the last record. Late 70s, and this takes me back. This was actually their last record with this lineup before a plane crash, and the original artwork on the front had flames on it, and they discontinued that for this record here. But anyways, very good record. I just love it. I listened to it. I think Ronnie Van Zandt was an amazing vocalist. That's Ronnie right there. Very good. Very good record. I was shocked when I heard about the plane crash. Anyways, that brings back a lot of good memories. I just, the old southern rock genre, but they really kicked ass. They really did. Would love to have seen them live. Okay, my last one. Straub's Hero and Heroine. Fabulous record. If you're not into this type of music, it's what they called, progressive rock back then. You know, that sort of thing. You know, hit music, you know. We used to smoke a lot of doobies and listen to this, you know. I saw Straub's. There was two opening acts. I can't remember the name of the first opening act, but the second opening act was REO Speedwagon. And then Straub's from England. They're an English band, originally called the Strawberry Hill Boys. And they shortened it to Straub's, but very good record. Wasn't a big turnout for the concert because they weren't very well known over here at the time, but I have a lot of their records, Ghosts and several others. So, that's it for my records, but I've still got about 300 more. And all my records, I can look at them and say, oh, I remember when I got this, because it's not a record in my collection. I can't pull out and say, oh yeah, I remember, where it was then, the time that I bought it in my life, what year pretty much. And unfortunately, a lot of my records, I've traded over the years. They've come and gone, which is kind of unfortunate, but because I wish I had some of them back. But at least now with Spotify, I can still listen to that music, but so anyways, that's really all I have to say for now. But I thank you for tuning in, as always. I appreciate it. I hope you enjoy this. I have to apologize for the background noise. There's not a lot I can do about that. Unfortunately, it's not something you can always control, so I do my best, but I want to thank you for tuning in, and I love it when you leave me comments, because I read every single comment, and I always subscribe to people who send me comments. Now, just because I don't respond to your comments doesn't mean I didn't read them, okay? And sometimes I will respond. It might take me a week or two. I'm sure some people think, why is he responding now? I wrote that a week ago, but just because I don't respond doesn't mean I don't read them, okay? And I appreciate it very much. So anyways, I want to thank you for tuning in. And once again, my friends, I hope that you're in a good place and you're happy and healthy and that you are surrounded by love and that you're looking after yourself and each other, okay? You take care. And once again,